Good evening to all. Today's topic is basic of network. Okay. So let us see the basic of network. What are the contents I am going to cover in the session? So the contents here are talking about the MAC address. That's what's in the layer 2. Then the IP address, which is also called as the logical address, that's working the layer 3 of the OSI reference model. Then checking the MAC table, which will be loaded in the switch. Then IP configuration. We will look into the two ways of configuring IPv4, static and dynamic. Then we will have a configuration of routers. Okay, so how to assign the IP address to the interfaces, how to make the interface up. Then we will look into the protocol, any one of the specific protocols, either static or dynamic, any one of the dynamic protocol. Okay, then validating the routing table. Okay, how the routing table will be get updated once we are configured any routing protocol. Final topic is access control list. Okay. So coming to MAC address, everyone is clearly aware that MAC address is a 48-bit address. This is made up of a combination of hexadecimals. So the value between 0 to 9 and E to F. Okay, so if all the bits are 1 means, which represents the flooded MAC address, that in the sense the broadcast MAC address, which is used to flood the information from a source to any destination. Okay, so that's the last, all the bits will become ones. Okay, so it starts from zeros and ends with all the bits IF. Okay, so 0 to 9 to 8 IF. Okay, to exactly identify the MAC address in a machine, we can use the command get MAC. So in a command prompt, if you are using a get MAC command, you can see the list of physical address which are enabled or which are configured on a specific laptop or a desktop. Okay, so it's depend upon the adapters, which means if you have multiple adapters, you will see multiple number of MAC address. Okay, if you want to clearly look into which adapter it belongs to, the MAC address belongs to which adapter, you can use the command IP config, okay, which is the command used for check the IP address, include /all/all, that represents all the ethernets or all the interfaces which are configured or which are created on the system, laptop or the desktop. Okay, and there you can specifically look into the adapter. So if you are seeing the wireless LAN adapter, this is the MAC address. Okay, so like that you can identify the MAC address. Either you can use the get MAC. If you have a single adapter, it will be directly show this is the adapter MAC address, whereas if you have multiple adapters if you confirm the IP address, confirm the physical address, you can use the IP config /all. Okay, so the MAC address is also called as physical address. Okay, so which works in the layer 2. So let us see when the MAC address will be updated to the switch in the later version. Currently I am specifying how to validate the MAC address of a specific device. So coming to the layer 3 network layer, we will use IP address, internet protocol address. Okay, here I am going to talk about IPv4, not IPv6. So IPv4 is a 32-bit address made up of dotted decimals. So you have clear idea of IPv4. Okay, whenever you are typing any IP address, you will type as 10.0.0.1, or you can type as 192.168.10.1. So it's a dotted decimals. It's a decimal and segregated with dot in between the blocks. Okay. So the IPv4 is made up of four blocks. Okay. As I explained to you, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Each block is a single octet. It has made of single octet. That means it's a value of 8 bits. So if you want to write a value 10, the binary value is 00001010. Okay, this will represent the decimal value as 10. Okay, so this 8 bits forms a single octet. Okay, so you can use a network, or you can use a class that classes from 0 to 255. So the IPv4 is ranges from 0 to 255. That in the sense 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8. So all the bits are zeros or all the bits are one. That is the range of your IPv4. So the range is from 0 to 255. That range is classified into 5 classes. Okay. A, B, C, D, and E. The range A have 0 to 127 here. It have the first block is enabled as the network blocks. Rest of the blocks are what we can say it is the host blocks. Okay. So everyone aware that if a network block changes, we need a layer 3 device to communicate. In the sense, class A, the first bit, if you are using 10.0.0.x/8, if the network changes to 11 network, you need to have a router, the layer 3 device for communication. Okay. So the first block represents a network, the rest of the blocks are represented as host blocks. The class B is ranges from 128 to 191, where first two blocks will be the network blocks. That in the sense 172.16.0.0. This will be the representation of a network. So the first two blocks will be the network blocks. The rest of them will be the host block. So any value changes in between these two blocks will be have a layer 3 device for communication. So coming to class C, we have a range of 192 to 223. Here will comes, if you are taking IP 192.168.10.0/24, the first three blocks represent it as a network blocks. Okay, the last block will be the host blocks. So increasing the network blocks will reduce the host bits. Okay, in the sense, if you are taking a class A network, you can use 2 power 24 number of IP addresses. Okay, if you are using a class B network, you can use 2 power 16 IP address. Whereas if you are using a class C, you will get 2 power 8 only. So whenever a network bit increases, the host block will be reduced. Okay. The term here I represent /8/16/24. This will represent this belongs to a specific class A, B, or C. But we can modify the CID or classless interdomain routing value to what is the required host we want. Okay, that in the sense we can modify the CIDR value and increase the network block depend upon the host we required. Okay, so that time is called as subnetting. So we will use A, B, and C. The D, we have the range of 224 to 239, which is used for multicast purpose. Class E is ranges from 242 to 255, which is reserved, and it is used for broadcast purpose. Okay. So in a class A, the last blocks that 127 block belongs to loopback address, okay, which is used to self test your machine, whether your Ethernet adapter is working or not, in or your machine is function properly. That means the network adapter is working properly or not. We can use the 127.0.0. any IPs, okay, which in the sense, if you are trying to ping any IP address, for example, I am trying to ping 127.0.0.50, okay, there is no destination, but still you will get the response. That in the sense, your machine is self-testing yourself and responding to the output. Okay, if you are getting any request timeout, your adapter is not working properly. So this will termed as local host also. Okay, some of the real-time environment, local host colon, they specify the port to validate. Okay, that will self-test and validate whether the service is running or not in a server. Okay, so the best application I can suggest is, there is an application called TCPink. Okay, you heard about this TCPink, okay, which is used to validate whether any service port is working or not in a local host or a remote host. Okay, let us see that term. TCPink download. So it's a free version you can download from the internet. Okay, I am creating it, downloading the tcping.exe file. No need to execute this file, we can use it directly. Let me show you how to use. So we need to go to the folder where it is downloaded. From there we can use open PowerShell option. Okay, nowadays the Windows machines are coming up with PowerShell. So here we can use the command /tcpink. Okay, let me check IP 8.8.8.8. Okay, for the specific port number 53. Okay, so I have validated the Google IP address, that is 8.8.8 is the DNS server of the Google. There I am sure that the port number 53, which is the DNS port, whether it's open or not, we can validate like this. Okay, so it is a very useful command which we can use in a real-time environment to validate a specific destination have the specific port is enabled or not. Okay, in some cases the engineers will come or the developers will come, please open the firewall request between source and destination. In that time we can validate whether the source destination having the specific port is open or not. So it's a best tool to validate TCPink. Okay, so coming back, I am talking there about the loopback. Okay, let us see any of the services running on my machine or not. Okay, so 127.0.0.1 space 3389. This is the RDP port. Okay, so I am not getting no response because I am not enabled RDP on my current machine. That's what we are getting, a error, no response. Okay, if you are getting output as port is opened, that represents the service port is up and running. Okay, if you are hosting any web browser, web servers, there also you can validate with the 127.0.0.1.10. Okay, if you are hosting any specific web files in your machine, you can check the 443 ports. Okay, so current machine having the port 443 is open. My machine having 8 is open. Okay, whereas the port 8 is not responding. So now you are getting right why we are using a loopback address. This is used to validate what are their services or our Ethernet adapter is running on our machine or not. Okay, so I have introduced to you a term called TCPing. Okay. So in a class A, I specified the specific network loopback. Okay, in a class B, we have a network called APIPA, Automatic Private Internet Protocol Address. Okay, this is used to allocate IP address to the machine itself, which in the sense, as I told you, okay, if I am going to the command, the command ncpa.cpl, okay. This is the shortcut used to go to the adapter, okay. Right click, properties. We are talking about IPv4, so specify the internet protocol version 4 and click the properties. There are two ways we can allocate IP address, either static or dynamic. Okay, in my machine it is using dynamic allocation. In the sense, it will check for the DHCP server to get an IP address. In some case, suppose if the DHCP server is not there, the machine itself allocate an IP address, that is called as APIPA, which will be in the range of 169.254.x.x/16. Okay, so if any of the machine is getting an IP range of 169.254, there we can specify it is itself allocating, that means the DHCP server is not responding to the end machine. Then talking about the private IPs, the below subnets are part of the private IP address of class A, B and C. Okay, this is non-routable to internet, which means these IPs are not accessible from the internet, whereas this IP will be get NATed for accessing. Okay, this will be used inside a organization, not accessing outside. So the next topic is MAC address. So MAC address tables, which is main. So I showed you how the MAC address looks like in a physical box. This MAC address will be maintained by a L2 switch for forwarding a traffic from a source to destination. Suppose a switch doesn't know the exact MAC address which need to be forwarded. If the MAC address is not updated, the switch will flood the information to all the port except where it is received. Okay. So MAC address will be updated whenever any new frames comes to the ingress memory. So let me show you the practical session of that. So we are using the Cisco Packet Razor. We are going to configure 3 PCs. Which is going to connect to a single switch. And we will assign a static IP address. So once you are connected the cables to the switch from the PCs, automatically the ports will get enabled as it's a L2 device. Okay, let us go to configure the IP address statically. So desktop IP address, I'm going to use a network 10.0.0.1 and the subnet mask of 255.0.0.0. This is what it is called as a class A network. 10.0.0.2. And for your understanding, I am going to modify the last PCS 11 network. So I am sure that you guys are clearly aware that 10 will never communicate with 11. The first block of the class A have been modified. Okay. So if you are validating the MAC table, this command is show MAC address table. Okay, so currently there is no MAC address stored in the switch. So if you are pinging PC2 to PC0, the packet sent successfully. Now you can see the information that two of the MAC address has been LANed. Let us ping from PC2 to PC1. Okay, 10 is communicating to 11. Failed. Let's see whether anything is updated. Okay, there is nothing is updated because there is no response which is sent from the PC1 to the PC2. That's what it is not updated. Whereas if I'm trying for opponent side, the vice versa, the communication will be get failed. But still the MAC address is not saving. Okay. So 10 will never communicate with 11. So this is about the MAC table. So the MAC table will be maintained by switch. And for your info, if any PC is idle for 5 minutes, the MAC address will be get reset. Let me show you that also. Okay. Currently we are in 1 hour 7 minutes. I am fast forwarding to 1 hour 12 minutes. Okay. Now look at your MAC table. This wind up. The reason is the PCs are idle for more than 5 minutes. Okay. So you can validate the MAC table in the switch. Okay. So this MAC table will be differ based upon the configuration of a real-time environment. Now I am talking about the global MAC table. Okay. So let us see some configuration practical wise. Okay. Okay, as we specified, we are going to practice the same in the Cisco packet raiser. Okay. So I am going to introduce the server to allocate the IP address. You guys are now aware that how to configure a static IP address. Now I am coming with the server. And we can have more LANs. 2, 3, 2, 3. And a server to allocate the IP address. And going to host the HTTPS service. So introduce connection switch. Okay, a simple scenario.
We are going to use
okay, so I am going to use the network 192.168.10 here, 20 here, and 30 here, and here I will use the network 1.1.network. Okay, let me keep as a note. So then. So I'm keeping the note here. So here we are using 192.168.10.0/24. Here I am going to use 192.168.20.0/24. And here we are going to use 192.168. So instead of that, we can use 172. So this 172.16.0.0/. So let me configure the server first. Okay, desktop IP address, because it's a DHCP server, we need to assign the static IP address 192.168.10.10 with the default class, and default gateway is 192.168.10.1. Okay, going to the services, we need to enable DHCP. Okay, it need to be powered on, and the default gateway is 192.168.10.1. Okay, and I am reserving the IP till 50. The first IP need to be 51. Okay, so the machine who is going to get the first IP, it will get the IP address of 192.168.10.51. Okay, so it's clearly allocating with the term called first come first serve mechanism. So this machine will get 52, and the last machine will get 53. I hope you guys are clear for allocating the IP address. Similarly, I am going to configure the second LAN 192.168.20.10, the default subnet mask, and 192.168.20.1 is the default gateway. Going to services, I am going to enable the DHCP service, and the default gateway is 20.1. Okay, my practice is I will allocate always the first IP address as the default IP. Okay, that is not required. Any IPs can be the default IP. My best practice is I am using always the first IP. In some environment, they may use the last IP address 254 as the default gateway. It depends. So the LAN 2 also configured. Coming to here, we are going to configure the server here. Just stop. So we are 172.16.0.1.1. I am going to use 10. 172.16.0.1. Going to the services, DHCP server on. Here I am going to modify from 100.1. Because the third octet is also a host octet. So here you can see you'll get the IP from 100.1 as the first IP. .2 as the second IP and 100.3 as the third. Okay, so the end machines are allocated. Let me configure the routers. Okay, so you are sure that the routers interfaces are still showing down. The reason is the interface is in down state. Okay, let us see what is the interfaces. Here F1/0 and 1/1. Okay, F1/0 and F0/0 and the serial interface 2/0. Here the interface is connected with 0/0 and 2/0. Okay, let me go to the command line. Okay, would you like to enable the initial configuration? You need to give no. Okay, if you are providing yes, it will ask some questions. We need to answer one by one. So we are moving to the privilege mode, and if you are executing the command configure terminal, it will move to global configuration mode. The command is interface fast ethernet 0/0. Okay, IP address which is connected to the LAN 2. So the IP address is the default gateway of the LAN 2, 192.168.20.1 with the subnet mask 255.255.255.0. Okay, whenever you are giving a command no shutdown, until or unless if you are not specified no shutdown, the interface will be in down state. That represents, here it is red. Okay, that means the interface is shutdown state. Now I am enabling the interface. Okay, now it's changed to green. Now the interface fast ethernet 1/0 that is connecting to our LAN 1. IP address 192.168.10.1 255.255.255.0. No shutdown. Okay, so interface serial 2/0 that is connecting to the router to the router. Okay, so we need to have a two IP address. One is to configure this router, another is to configure the next router. So we can use the subnet /30. Okay, I am allocating the IP address 1.1.1.1 255.255.255.252, which is the subnet mask for /13. No shutdown. Okay, still the interface is down because the neighbor interface is in down state. Okay, CLI no, enable configure terminal interface fast ethernet 0/0. Okay, you can use no shutdown first, no problem. Okay, then IP address 172.16.0.1 255.255.0.0. okay, the final interface is interface serial 2/0. No shutdown. Okay, now the interface provided no shutdown, it comes up. Okay, IP address 1.1.1.1 is already used. You can use 255.255.255.252. Okay, checking the interface table is, the command is show IP interface brief. Okay, here you can see we have multiple interfaces where we have enabled only two interfaces. One is F0/0 which is connecting to the LAN, and the another interface which is connecting to the router to router. Okay, whereas if you are validating the router 0, you can see show IP interface brief, we have enabled three interfaces because we have two LANs and interface which is connecting to the neighbor. Okay, so As you are aware that LAN 1 can communicate with LAN 2, the first packet will be get dropped, okay, and communication successfully passed to the LAN 2. Whereas LAN 1 and 2 aren't able to communicate with the LAN 3. The reason is routing protocol is not yet enabled. Okay, so I am going to configure the routing protocol called EAGRP. So the command is, okay, go back to the global configuration mode, configure terminal, router EIGRP. You need to specify an autonomous system number that should be same between the routers. Okay, which means whatever number you have specified in the router 0 should be same to the router 1. So I am using the number 10. Okay, and address the known networks with the command network keyword network 192.168.10.0 network 192.168.20.0 and the third network is 1.0.0.0. Okay, if you want to use the proper update, you can use the command called no auto summary. Okay, this will specifically represent the CIDR value properly. So let us go back to the router 1, configure terminal, router EIGRP. Okay, you can use any number between 1 to 65,535. In a real time environment, you will get millions of IP, millions of autonomous system number range. Where here we are going to use the same one, because if you are modifying the autonomous system number, we need to either configure a redistribution between the EIGRP to EIGRP. So I am using the same number 10. Network 172.16.0.0. Network 1.0.0.0. Okay, that's from the neighborship between the routers. Okay, show IP route. You have got the update from the neighbor. 10.0 and 20.0 will be reachable via the serial interface 2/0 by reaching the IP 1.1.1.1. So now if you are testing your ping, this will succeed. Okay, as we are enabled the routing table, the machine from the LAN 1 can communicate with LAN 2, LAN 1 can communicate with LAN 3, as well as LAN 2 can communicate with LAN 3. Okay. So we have covered the topics. Still, how to validate the routing table. So we have validated the routing table using the command show IP route. Okay, so if you want to validate any routing table, you can use the command show IP route. Okay. In this, you can clearly see the code C represents directly connected, which in the sense, whatever networks are connected to the interface, that all are represented as class C, not class C, the code C. Okay, whereas any of the network is LAN'd using the routing protocol, that will have the different code. Here it is representing D. D represents the table is updated with the help of EIGRP routing protocol. Okay, suppose if you have configured static routing protocol, then you will see yes. Okay, instead of static or EIGRP, you have configured with RIP, you will see the code as R. If you go on through OSPF, it releases Okay, so this is the way we can validate the routing table globally. Show IP route EIGRP. If you are specifying this, it is filtering only the routing table which is LAN, which is addressed with the help of EIGRP, or which is LAN with the help of EIGRP. So this is the only network which is LAN from the neighbor using EIGRP. Okay, going to the R1, the router 1. Okay, if you are executing, just a couple of minutes, guys. Okay, so if we validating the router 1, so let us see that enable in the privilege mode, we can execute the command show IP route. Okay, this will include all the routing, including the directly connected as well as LAN with the EIGRP. If you want to filter EIGRP, you can use the command show IP route EIGRP. Okay, this is filtering only the two networks which are LAN from the neighbor using EIGRP. Okay, so now let us go back to the access control list. Okay, I'm sure you guys are aware about that. Okay, let us validate some of the basic things. Let me try to connect the HTTP service :/192.168.10.10 is the server, right, where I am hosting the HTTP service. So if you are seeing here, HTTP and HTTPS services are hosted in that device. So if I am trying to connect, I can able to access the server in both HTTP as well as HTTPS. Okay, so current I am going to, okay, I want to deny the traffic from this server to the entire subnet of this LAN 3. Okay, what I am coming to tell is, need to configure the access control list to filter the specific server, but I can access this server in both HTTPS and 443, but in this server only 443 need to be accessed. So let us configure that. So I am in R1, the router 1. Okay, the command is IP access list. Okay, there are two types of access list is there. In general, okay, that is called as standard or extended. So here I specify the source and destination. So I am using extended access list. Okay, once you have selected or picked a specific access list, there are two options. Either you can use named access list or numbered. I am using name. Okay, I am going to create access list with the name JD. Okay, my thing is deny TCP service. Okay, I am going to deny the TCP service. For the source, okay, you need to specify the source 172.16.0.0 with the wildcard mask 0.0.255.255, because it's a /16 network. Okay, to the host, what is the host IP? 192.168.10.10, which is equal to port number 80. You can specify either 80 or you can specify WWW. It's up to you. Okay, the rest of them need to be allowed. So permit TCP any source to any destination is allowed. Okay, now going to the specific interface, the interface is fast ethernet 0/0, IP access group JDE. Okay, now let us validate. So https://192.168.10.10. Okay, the communication is there. Whereas if I'm trying to connect http://192.168.10.10, request timeout, which in the sense from any of this LAN you can't able to communicate this server, whereas if you are trying to connect the neighbor LAN 2, you can able to access the port 480. So to validate that, you can use the command show IP access list. Here you can see the match count, how many packets are dropped and how many packets are allowed. That's how we can configure a source to destination using a extended access list. Hope this may be informative for you.